Welcome everybody to the next talk, Muse MTD in User Space from Richard Weinberger. Please find a seat and then let's get started.
So, then let's get started. I'm way too loud, I feel. That's better. Yeah, hello, my name is Richard. I'm co-founder of Sigma Star GmbH, a small contracting company based in Austria. We do mostly stuff focusing on Linux and security. I have special interest in Linux itself and low-level components and security. I ended up also maintaining various components in the Linux kernel, and one of them is UBI and UBIFS, a subsystem and file system based for raw NAND. And today I would like to talk a little bit about Muse. Actually, the goal is not that I'm promoting Muse, the goal is that I will explain you the journey, how I ended up with Muse and how this can help you also. Because Muse is based on Fuse, the file system in user space, and in my opinion, it's rather underestimated how powerful Fuse is and what cool stuff you can do with it. So first I will talk a little bit why Fuse, then why I chose Fuse to implement Muse, confusing words, then a few details on the implementations, and then more details on Fuse itself and a small guideline how you can use Fuse to create your own subsystem user space. Oh, that was a bad name. Fuse and Muse. And, anyway. As I'm one of the raw NAND guys, so MTD guys, I do a lot of testing of MTD device drivers and also MTD file systems. That means somebody has a problem and UBI or UBIFS or JFS is acting weird, and then they send me a bug report, and sooner or later I get an image of the raw NAND device and have to make sense out of this. Usually I don't have the hardware, so I don't can flash it to the exact device. I can just look at the image. Looking at the image at a hex editor is kind of tedious. I do it sometimes, but usually I try to have the customer device more or less simulated, that I can load in the NAND dump and then try debugging UBIFS or UBI and see why it's not working. We have already plenty of simulators in the kernel. For example, we have MTD RAM, we have block to MTD, we have NAND sim, but we have also support for virtual flash devices in QEMU. So there is already a lot of tooling there, but it didn't really fit for me. First, a few details on the existing tooling we have. So MTD RAM is, as the name states, an MTD device that operates in RAM. It's actually a vmalloc memory region. So when you configure MTD RAM to use to simulate for you a megabyte-sized flash device, it does vmalloc on a megabyte. I think it's obvious that this doesn't scale. It's good enough that you can emulate a spy node device, although it's of type MTD RAM, but you can use it good to debug issues for JFS2. Because JFS2 was designed for really small NOR flashes, and when you just need a vmalloc 4 megabytes, it's good enough. One of the bigger drawbacks is that you can only have one instance, so you can configure the MTD RAM emulator by loading the kernel module and pass as kernel parameter or as config option the size of the chip you want to have, so only one. And there's no way to have fault or error injection. Ha, it works the laser. And that's okay for inspecting existing NAND images, but I would like also to runtime testing. So when I change something in JFS2, then I want to do testing in a virtual environment and inject some errors. I handle bit flips or bad blocks or whatever, so some of the behavior you would expect from a dying flash chip. And this is something that is not there. There's a second device that can emulate us, a Raman-typed MTD that's good enough for SpyNOR or NOR in general. It's block to MTD. As the name states, it operates on a block device. So basically, you can turn an existing block device into an MTD. So you usually you don't use your real hard disk as MTD. You use a loopback file and then feed it as MTD. It's more or less the same as MTD RAM. It also implements the plain MTD interface, so it does not implement, for example, the NOR flash MTD subsystem or the NAND flash MTD subsystem. It's really an MTD. In contrary to MTD RAM, it allows multiple instances, but also only to be configured at module load time. There is some hackery around that you can configure it using sysfs, so you can change the kernel parameters in sysfs, but this doesn't really work because the MTD subsystem itself has no knowledge about hot plug. So when you remove the MTD device, you are in deep trouble. But it's good enough for UBI and UBIFS testing because you can have larger devices with a few megabytes. But since it's emulating a NOR style device, UBI will go in NOR flash mode and you don't have any support for vier leveling. So UBI doesn't do any vier leveling. So when you want to debug the vier leveling semantics of UBI, blocked MTD is not you want to use. Same with MTD RAM, there's also no support for fault or error injection. Then there's a third one, it's called NANSIM. This is the most used, I would say. It operates completely in RAM, but instead of allocating a whole memory region for the whole device, it's k-mallocing individual NAND pages. There is certain support that you can swap out pages to a file, but this is a little bit hacky. You have to pass a file name to the kernel module while loading, and you cannot configure NANSIM in a way that it can use an existing image. It can only swap out data. It's a little bit hacky and it breaks over the time. The biggest difference between MTD RAM and block to MTD is that NANSIM is actually emulating a NAND chip itself. It emulates all the NAND commands the NAND framework would send to a chip. So it's really the chip hardware implemented in software. And that's why it's directly interacting with the MTD NAND framework. So the NAND framework is then sending regular NAND commands to the simulator and it will act upon that. Since it's simulating a NAND flash, it's really nice to test UBI and UBIFS. So you have vier leveling and all that NAND specialties. It has also support for ECC. So it supports Reed Solomon and BCH. Of course, only in memory. Now you think, why would I have ECC of the NAND chip in memory? It turned out to be really useful to find a double writing of the same page because then the ECC checksum doesn't match anymore and you can catch it also using NANSIM. There is also partition support for error injection. You can tell NANSIM to add randomly bit flips or other faults, but it's configured in a static way. You can also configure NANSIM to delay certain operations, for example, that a NAND erasure should take a certain amount of microseconds, or also page read and write should be delayed. And you can configure partitions. So using the kernel command line, you can configure NANSIM to add multiple partitions, so it's more or less able to have multiple instances, but also, again, in a static way. As you have guessed, emulating a NAND chip in software is slow. That's why NANSIM is also not the fastest one. It's good enough to test UBI and UBIFS, but it's really not fast. and it turned out to be rather errorsome. There's also some interesting fact about it. You cannot say, NaNSim, give me an end device of size X. The thing is, NaNSim is really tied to the NAND framework itself, and the NAND geometry is commuted from a NAND identifier. So you have to say, NaNSim, please emulate me a NAND chip with these identifiers, and then NaNSim does the identifier parsing and constructs from that the page size, the erase size, and the number of erase blocks. And using the read-id command, this is then communicated to the kernel. So it's really the chip itself. And there are some tables, even in the MDD utils, we have a script that will generate you some NAND identifiers. But the problem is, modern NAND chips have also the ONFI identifier NAND page, and in this page, there's the real geometry, and the NAND identifier is not the real geometry. So when you want to emulate a chip where the NAND ID is not right, but the ONFI page, then you're in trouble. 3 or 4 years ago, I created a patch for NaNSim. It's actually on a mailing list that NaNSim can emulate an ONFI identifier page, but we decided to not merge it and better think about a new way how to do NAND chip emulation. That's why I'm here. NaNSim was good to find errors in UBI and of course also in the MDD NAND framework, because the NAND framework is exchanging NAND commands with NaNSim, but these days we find mostly bugs in NaNSim itself. So it's more or less a maintenance burden, and I try to get rid of it. The third class is QEMU. So QEMU can also emulate flash devices, mostly used to get UEFI support. I think it supports only serial NOR flashes, but I'm not so sure about that. But for my case, it's too inflexible, and it's not really a gain. And there's also no way to have fault or error injection. So at the end of the day, I was unhappy with the state of how can we have a virtual MDD. Having all these MDD devices in hardware is also not an option, because I cannot not endless flash real hardware. It's slow and will burn down my NAND chips, and they will die soon or later. So I want to have it as a virtual machine. So first, I would like to have an option that I can add and remove MDD devices at runtime. So add me a few NAND chips, remove a few, just to have a decent test farm. That was my first topic on the list. Then I would like to have emulation for NOR and NAND style MDDs. And I also would like to have support for various image formats. When I take a dump of an NAND chip, I use the NAND dump command. But there are many other ways to capture the contents of a NAND chip, vendor-specific ones or low-level ones from the bootloaders. Sometimes you get it with out-of-band data, sometimes without, sometimes the format is vendor-specific. So I thought about a way, how can I add an interface that will support many different formats? And also, I would like to have a way that I have more control over error injection and fault injection. So not just make every ends read fail with a bit flip, make it more controllable. But that's all stuff that you cannot do in a kernel space. So that's why I thought, okay, let's think about a new MDD simulator. And first, I thought, okay, let's split it. Make the kernel part really simple and stupid, and try to do all the hard work in user space. When I have a user space library, then adding a vendor-specific format should be easy. When everything is done in kernel space, then adding a new proprietary format is not so nice and takes a lot of time, but in user space, I can do whatever I want. That was the main idea. And then I thought, how can I implement that? First, I thought, okay, let's create a new MDD driver and add some whatever interface to the user space. For example, a miscellaneous character device and do all the communication. While implementing the first proof of concept, I talked to myself, no, that can't be the right way. There must be something I can reuse. I don't want to add yet another kernel user space interface. That's too complicated. Maybe I can reuse something and save time. And I thought, yeah, let's use QEmu. There's this awesome virt.io stuff, and let's do a MDD virt.io driver. In theory, that should work, but then I need something that I can control from the user space or the QEmu. Then I need a second channel also. Then I need a channel between QEmu and MDD, also the kernel, and I need an interface between QEmu and my control program. And it turned out that's way more complicated than I wanted to have it, and binding it to QEmu also sounded not that nice. So I said, nah, let's try something different. This was the point where I was chatting with David, one of my coworkers, and he said, kind of just mock the MDD characteristics in user space using queues. And I was, oh, queues, there was queues. What's queues again? Oh, there's character device in user space. There's a special mode of views. I completely forgot about queues. So who of you knows queues? That's more than expected. So the basic idea behind queues was at a time where Linux gained support for ALSA, so the advanced Linux sound architecture, there was still the old framework, it was OSS, the open source sound system. And there have been many programs that could only communicate to OSS. And there were certain of control devices in depth to control OSS. And then the ALSA guys thought, okay, let's create something new, that we have a wrapper that we can actually emulate OSS in user space. And that's how queues was born. So they have been able using queues to implement OSS in user space. So it turned out that queues is just a special mode of views, or a subset. So it is a character device that can ask user space for every read, write, IO control, and whatever command, and you can then implement this like a user space file system. So for a bare character device, that works really well, but the problem is an MDD is more than a plain character device. Even when I really re-implement all the MDD characteristics using queues, the kernel still doesn't know that this queues device is really an MDD. And when I have something like UBI that stacks on top of an MDD device, it won't work on a character device. What I thought, that's a nice idea. Maybe I can do something like queues in a different way. And then I looked into the implementation of queues and thought it was just a few hundred lines of code that made use of the Fuse framework to actually emulate a character device. And that's how Muse was born. So as short recap, Fuse is file system in user space. That means you can implement a file system as user space program. For every file system operation, user space has to answer, so read, write, IO control, start. It's a very generic framework. I'm sure many of you have used SSHFS or NTFS3G. That's a very common file systems that are implemented in user space using Fuse. And by looking into what Fuse actually already offers, I realized that's good enough to implement also a flash device. To be honest, flash devices are rather stupid and simple, so there's no zero copy IO and other fancy modern stuff. It's just a plain read-write command using buffers, and that's doable with Fuse also. Then I thought, okay, let's give it a try. In Fuse, you have multiple operations. For example, you have Fuse read, you have Fuse write for the read-write commands, and I have added just a few more commands that are Muse specific, so a read, a write, an erase, and a method that you can mark bad blocks or check for good blocks, also in sync, and I made also make sure that we support out-of-band data and ECC. Actually, one of the hardest parts was the MTD lifetime. So if you remember on my wish list, one of the top posts was that I want to have support to add and remove MTDs at runtime. And the MTD framework had no idea about that. But when I have fused, the user space program will start and crash at some point. And when the user space program crashes, then the MTD will be gone. So I had to make sure that MTD can deal with all these dynamics. So that was one of the harder parts. But so far, my feature list is that I want to have snapshots that can be done completely in user space. That you have custom image support, so not just NAND, just any format you can think of. There's an interface that you can add your format if you want. And also that you can record and replay all operations. That is useful for power cut testing. So when I, for example, record all NAND operations of a file, read, write, and then stop at some point, and let's say I had 100 NAND operations and I replay only 50, then UBFS has to be in a position to recover from that. Currently, we do this just by randomly power cutting and hoping to catch the bad code paths. But when I can really replay every single command and then check whether UBFS can recover over each step, then I can catch every corner case. Also, fault injection that I can from user space say now after this type of write, add me a random bit flip. So I can make it much more sophisticated and not also just based on randomness. And of course, when the implementation of the MTD is in user space, I can also do fuzzing. So I can actually have a fuzzer harness that will fuzz UBIFS and change the NAND content on fly. This is just in progress. So right now I have a working emulator that can record and replay commands, and it's good enough that UBIFS is happy. It was less work than expected, so I had the first prototype within a single day. So Fuse had really a lot of stuff I could reuse. I was really impressed. Yeah, I said that already. So I consider the kernel part is done. It has roughly around 1,000 lines of code. It's not mainline yet, because I'm still playing with user space. And as long as I'm not really happy with user space, I don't want to fix the kernel part, because adding more fuse commands is something you really have to justify. And I want to be sure that this set of fuse commands I've added are really what I need, and not after half a year I say I need 10 more commands. So I'm playing with user space. Currently, it's written in C. It's based on libfuse low level, but I'm also playing with Rust just because. I've talked now about fuse for me, for testing and inspecting NAND issues, but there's also a corner case I have to talk about. I don't want to, but I have to. The thing is, when Fuse is mainline, then it's also possible to implement a real MTD driver in user space. So, for example, when you have a spy NOR device, you can use spydev and communicate using spy commands in user space, and then implement also the MTD in user space. So, in theory, then you can create your MTD driver without making it open source. People have asked me for that. I do not recommend it, but technically that should be possible then. That's one of the things me and the other NAND guys or Flash guys are not so sure whether we should merge Fuse or not, but it depends. So you can create then, of course, really slow drivers, but you can keep them closed source. That's one of the downsides. Same as with Fuse. Many Fuse for SM drivers are not open source, because only the kernel has to be TPL. So now I have talked a lot about views, but actually I want to tell how you can do this for your kind of device. First, we need to talk about views in more detail. So views is a client-server architecture where the user space is the server. The kernel is the client. This is sometimes really strange when you read libraries that the kernel is the client and you are the server. On the kernel side, you have always a rather generic driver. Currently, we have just for views, we implement the VFS interface, of course, to have a file system. And queues implements a miscellaneous character device. In my case, Muse implements a generic MDD driver. And in your case, you add your own stub. All the communication between the client and the server is based on requests. The requests are made by the client, so in this case, by the server. Each request contains an operation, and this are these operations I've talked before, and these are part of the kernel ABI, so you cannot change them later. So you have to come with a set of supported operations, and you can only add operations. It's also important to note that that always the client makes the requests and the server is just reacting on that. It's not in both directions. And each request contains a pair operation input and output structure. So the type of operation is only an integer, but you can send a structure with it that describes your operation in detail, and then you reply with another struct that's then the answer. For example, the command fuse write. That's the fuse command that's executed when you try to read from a file. So when the write system call happens through the kernel VFS, at some point the generic fuse file system driver in the kernel will create a fuse write request to the client, and it will send to the server, and it will send to the server a struct fuse write in, its input for the server, and it describes the write request. For example, here we have the file handle, the offset, the size, a few flags, and embedding. Using this struct, then the fuse server in user space knows what operation and which parameters should be done. And then it does the operation, and it will answer with the out structure, and in case of a write, it's just size. It will answer with how many bytes it wrote. It's important to note here that we have to add embedding, because everything has to be 64-bit aligned. It's also important to note that you use here data types that are valid for 64 and 32 bits. That's important when you have a combat mode user space. So kernel runs in 64-bit and user space in 32 bits. So it's really important to get these structures right when you have to have changes here. You need a new operation. So the request is actually a set of multiple I/O vectors, and usually the answer contains about at least three vectors. It's the fuse out header. It's just a very generic header that tells whether the operation at all worked or not. It could also state an internal error. Then you add your very specific output structure for the operation. In this case, it's fuse write out. It describes the actually result of the operation, and optional, you can add a payload, so a buffer with a length. So for a fuse read command, you would answer with a payload because you have read something. And it's also important to note that also the request can contain a buffer. So when you have writing, then the request for the write command contains a buffer with the data you want to write. So this is a little guide for you how to create your own driver framework. First, you have to look at all the existing fuse operations and their structures, whether you can reuse them. The chances are good that they can reuse some of them. If not, you have to add new one. They are all in the kernel tree in the UAP folder. That means they are UAP. They are not changeable. If you break something there, then Linux will shout at you. So make sure that when you define this and upstream them, that everything is good. You cannot change them. You can just add new operations. Second, you need a control character device. Oh, 5 minutes. For example, Fuse has dev fuse. When you open this device, then you can mount a new fuse file system. You can create your own. It's just setting up the fuse communication channel, and then the kernel will send the init operation to your server, and then the communication is ready to process requests. Next step is you have to add to the kernel a generic device driver. So in my case, it was a very generic MDD device driver that is just implementing the MDD subsystem and taking all the MDD read-write commands and transforming them into fuse requests. And then you have to glue all this in lib fuse low level. Of course, you can also handle the requests directly. So then you have to do a lot of more work, because then you have to encode and decode all the fuse operations on your own. But that's the main way how to do it. So I will have to speed on a little bit. Here's an example for the fuse is bad command. So the input is just an address, and the address is the block, and user space will then decide whether this block in the emulator is good or bad, and then it will answer with a result. It can be 0 or 1, and here again badding, because we have to make sure we are aligned to 64 bits. In the kernel part, we have the is bad callback of MDD, and all it's doing, it's creating a fuse request. There are plenty of helper methods in the kernel. So here I'm reusing the fuse simple request function to create me a request. And instead of talking to the hardware, I'm sending a request to the user space. In user space, the library checks whether the program is implementing this function. If not, it replies with enosys. And the application then actually has to implement the function. Here I'm really sneaky. I just say, based on randomness, whether the block is good or bad, and send a replay. And in the fuse low-level side, you have to have a helper that is actually constructing for you the fuse request. Here you see all the I/O vectors. But that's just an implementation detail. So as quick summary, fuse offers a really nice and powerful framework for communication between user space and kernel space. It's really versatile and offers much more than just file systems. You can do really complicated stuff. And adding support for MDD was way less work than I've expected. As I said, my first proof of concept was done within a day. And for the case with QEMU and WirtIO, I gave up after, I guess, 3 days. Just as a rough estimation. So that's it on Fuse. I hope you had some fun. I had it. If there are questions or comments, please go ahead. Yeah, there's a question.
So
there's a question, Dana.
Yeah, other hands.
So I'm Pavel Machek. I wrote network block device long time ago. I wanted to ask, do you have any solution to prevent deadlocks?
To prevent what?
Deadlocks.
Yeah, the deadlock prevention happens in Fuse. The good thing is Fuse has a way that the communication cannot block. When the communication fails, then on the kernel side, you get an error code. It's a disconnect, and then you know that the user space part is gone or deadlocked. So it's basically the same with file systems.
Okay, I'm not sure, but you really don't want to use this in production, and you may have problems if you write too much data to your device, because you will run out of memory and...
Yeah, that's why I said it, its main purpose is for testing that. So, of course, when your user space server is hostile and decides to block a read or write request forever, then you're in trouble, sure.
It's more case than if the device is in heavy use, kernel will run out of memory and swap out your server, not a hostile server. We may want to talk.
Yeah, sure, but that's a big problem with any kind of user space. But it's the very same when you decide to use NTFS 3G as your rootFS. Then you are in the very same trouble.
Okay, terrible idea. Any more questions? I don't see any hands. Let me check the virtual.
The virtual hands?
The virtual hands, but unfortunately, there are no virtual hands, though.
Yeah. Yeah, if there are any other questions, just talk to me. Thanks for your attention.
Yeah, thank you again.
Thanks. So.